Thank you. And thank God he woke us up this morning. You know, he didn't have to do it, but he did. You know, when I get up on Sunday morning, not only do I praise the Lord, but I also listen to the news. And I heard where there was a shooting in Maple Heights last night. That man did not get to see this day. He did not have the chance to praise God on Sunday morning. So I want to say good morning to all of you. Good morning to online believers. Good morning to Bethsaida Baptists. And if you get tired of being at the bedside, come on down to Christian Unity and worship with us. We're located at 16811 Broadway Avenue when the lights are bright.
Yes.
I'm glad to see you. It's nice to see you too. And we're here to praise the Lord.
Amen.
And I guarantee you, I guarantee you, if you come to this house of the Lord, you will give your praise on.
Yes.
God has been so good to us. He has just been blessing us and blessing us. And every time we turn around, it's another blessing.
Yes, it is.
You are welcome to sing, pray, and shout in Jesus' name.
In Jesus.
If we have any visitors, please stand and give us your church home. And if you don't have one, we can help you with that too.
Amen.
Do we have any visitors? I'm glad to see everybody's all home, folks. God bless you. Sit back, buckle your seatbelt, and enjoy the service. Get your praise up.
You are welcome.
Okay. Thank Sister Robinson for that hearty welcome she gave us all this morning, and I mean, it was almost like a wake-up feel.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, as soon as you walk in the house of the Lord, you should be perfectly at attendance to everything that's going on. We are here to uplift His name.
Amen.
Going to ask you to help us in our devotions.
Amen.
Let Jesus lead you. Let Jesus lead you. Let Jesus lead you all the way. All the way from earth to heaven. Let Jesus lead you. Amen.
exalt thee, my God, O King, and I will bless thy name forever and ever. Every day will I bless thee, and I will praise thy name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable.
Yes.
One generation shall praise thy works to another, and shall declare thy mighty acts. I will speak of the glorious honor of thy majesty and of thy wondrous works. And men shall speak of the might of thy terrible acts, and I will declare thy greatness. They shall abundantly utter the memory of thy great goodness, and shall sing of thy righteousness. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and of great mercy. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works. All thy works shall praise thee, O Lord, and thy saints shall bless thee.
Amen.
The last one heard the word of the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Woke up this morning with a mind. Stay on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind. Stayed on Jesus.
Father, each and every day we feel you closer and closer to us, Father.
Well,
Father, we like to thank you for each and every opportunity that you give us while we're on this earth, Father.
Yes, Lord.
Father, give us the courage to reach out to somebody that's in need, Father, that needs to hear about your goodness, Father. Father, let them know there is always another way to go, Father, not the way that man wants you to go, Father. Man said that you must act a certain way, you must do a certain thing, you must do all these things things to be accepted in this world, Father. But we know in your world, it's only one thing you must do, Father, and that's acknowledge Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. For that, Father, we say thank you.
Yes.
They try to make it out to be so hard, but it's so easy. It's so easy. It doesn't take anything. I guess that what man has a hard time wrapping his head around, that his salvation doesn't cost a thing. Father, we'd like to thank you for this church that we have. Father, I'd like to personally thank you for all the people that came before I did to stand before the congregation each and every Sunday. Bless them, Father. The ones that you have called home, Father, and the ones that are still here serving you, Father. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for the pastor that's going to bring the word here to this congregation, Father. May somebody hear exactly what they need to hear, Father. And may they do come down, running down the aisle, asking what they must do to be saved, Father. Father, thank you. Father, bless you. Voices of praise is going to sing the songs today, Father.
Yes, Lord.
Bless the usher there at the door that's going to greet the people that's coming in. And Father, bless the congregation that are here, willing to shout, dance, and scream your name, Father, all day long.
Right.
Just bless each and every last one of them, Father. And Father, when they leave here, let them be out there shouting your name and shouting the goodness of the Lord. Father, bless each and every last church that's opening your name today, Father. Father, let the pastor give the word to this congregation the way he sees it, not the way he wants to. Father, thank you. Bless the musicians that are here today.
Yes.
Father, let them play as hard as they can, Father. And may you hear them, Father, playing and acknowledge that they love you too. Father, just thank you for all the things that you make possible for me. Bless all the ones that are on the road on their way here, Father. Give them your traveling grace and mercy, Father, and bring them safely here. And Father, we ask of all these things in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Again, I'd like to thank each and every one of you for helping us in our devotional service. And I'd like to thank Sister Robinson for the hearty welcome. I do know it's one visitor here. He didn't stand when we asked for visitors, but I'm going to recognize him anyway because he's a good friend of mine, one of my classmates, Kelvin Whit. Would you stand, please? Some words.
No, I just feel confident I came here to visit this little church here.
Amen. All right. Glad you came.
Just go sit up and be incognito.
No, incognito is over. I know you.
That's all right.
That's one of my classmates. The man tracked together. You know, he's hard school. Just said. And without any further delay, I'm going to ask that Christian Unity Voices of Praise come and bless us in song.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Concerns God is everlasting. It never goes away. And I'm thankful, like I said, to be able to go back in centuries and hear some old hymns and so forth, and they still sound good. They still sound the same to me. And we truly have been blessed this morning. Our spirits have been uplifted in song and prayer. And now it's time for our elected pastor to come along and to also bring the word that never changes. And our pastor is Reverend Dr. Terry A. Webb. And he will be coming forward soon. But nevertheless, like I said, it's a pleasure just to be here, to be a part of this service. Truly, you know, we go places, we can go places and have a nice time, but it's nothing like coming in God's house.
Amen.
It's nothing like the things that he's going to give you, that he's going to put on your mind and in your heart. Sorry, I didn't see
Brother. Are you good?
I didn't want to take up too much time, but honestly, I didn't see him walk up here. I guess I was caught up in the spirit. Caught up with the voices of praise and singing. But nevertheless, I'm not going to detain you any longer. You're in the hands of our pastor, Dr. Terry A.
Amen, amen. Don't worry about it, brother. I imagine you didn't see me. This means I lost some more weight. I was turned sideways.
Okay.
To God be the glory. Amen, amen. So our visitor, I'm glad that you are here, because you've got to be epic to be friends with the legendary Paul Jones. Everywhere I've been with this man, somebody knows him. I was expecting him to be mayor of Cleveland, but he lives out here. He's well known and revered in a lot of places. People, oh, you know him? I'm like, that's awesome. I only hope that when I make it to where he is, yeah, I'm going to look, as y'all say, hot. It is hot in here. We got some good heat. Oh, yeah, do we? All right, there we go. All right, saints of God, I'm truly honored and privileged to be here one more time in God's house with you, worshiping with you in spirit and truth of our Lord and Savior. In this Advent season, we're approximately, 23 days away from the celebration of our Lord and Savior's birth. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. That means, too, that you should already have finished your Christmas shopping and everything, and ready to do everything else you need to do to worship God in spirit and in truth. Because I've seen Amazon trucks running around like evangelists in the 20s. Everywhere I go, I see them. They're parked across the street, down the street. I even saw one broken down the other day. It was working hard. And them and the postal guys, I saw a postal person working today. I'm like, wow. I hope they're getting OT. Whatever it is, but I'm just glad to see that the things are happening and everyone is doing well and everybody is blessed. But this morning, saints of God, I have something I want to ask you all, and I want your input. Sister Carter, thank you for letting me look at you and remember, before she beat me up. But I'm just kidding. But the thing of it is that saints of God, I was with some other preachers I know, and I know that this Christmas is on Sunday, which is the Lord's Day that we celebrate as Christians, most of all as Baptists. However, we are aware, too, that for the past 3 years, a lot of people have not been able to be with their family during the Christmas day because of COVID. However, I'm not married to either way. I'll be here at 9 o'clock in the morning on Christmas morning. I don't have a little kid, so I'm good. But what the suggestion on the floor was that we would have church at 10 o'clock on Christmas Eve. We would celebrate, get in, get out, and then we would have something televised the next day during this time. However, it is just a suggestion. If enough of you are not amenable to it, I will see you all Christmas morning in church. I'm okay with that. I have no problem with it. If it was a concert back in the day, I would have been at the concert on Christmas Day. Actually, Turkey Day that everybody celebrates, I think I did more clubbing than I did killing turkeys back in the day on Christmas, especially in college. We came home, we didn't come home, we came home to eat and party. So what I want you to do is at the end of service, you let me know. Or actually, I prefer if you just email me, that way I keep track of it, if you're okay with it. But if I just ask right now, no, that's putting pressure on people. You might, peer pressure is a killer for some people, so I don't want to do that. But just let me know, and then that way we can know what we can make plans to do. On Christmas Eve, that way you get to have Christmas Day all to yourself and the Lord. You never have a day without God, but you get to maybe travel and go spend time with your family. New Year's Eve day, we're not doing that because that's not a holiday. That's just a day that the clock calendar changes. There is no real celebration for New Year's. I thought about that and ran it through some veterans. That's not it. But that Christmas Eve, yeah. And so I'm praying, too, that everybody is in the right spirit for Christmas because Jesus is the reason for the season. It's not Black Friday. It's not Cyber Monday. It's not Crazy Wednesday. And it sure ain't Candle Day at Bath and Body Works. I heard more about that in the past 2 days than I have anything. It's Candle Day. It's Candle Day. Really? What does that mean? But I heard it, so I had to endeavor to find out. And my wife refreshed my memory because about 5 years ago, on Thanksgiving Eve or whatever that was, Black Friday, about 5 years ago, I humbly, ignorantly agreed to go to Bath and Body Works and purchase candles. Yeah, I laughed too afterwards. Oh, I was a dummy. I was in line for 6.5 hours with vicious little women with pointed elbows, and they were knocking me around, and I can't say anything because at that time I was the big black guy in this place in Macedonia that I couldn't. I was like, this is worse than a circus, but it is something about them candles. Oh my God, if we could get on fire like that for Jesus. I don't know what they put in them candles, but we need to rub it on the door every church in Cleveland. That's all I'm going to say. I'm just glad I made it home. That's all I can say. But it is what it is. But thanks to God, I'll be remiss. But be sure, you can even send me a note or something, a text or something about where you stand on that opportunity to do it. I'm even up to doing both, really. But that either Christmas Eve or that Sunday, just let me know. That way, too, our illustrious music department would then know what it is that they can and cannot do, too, and we'll be able to move forward. And I ask humbly, I beseech thee, I pray for thee, that you let me know in the next day or so, so that we can make appropriate arrangements to do what we need to do. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And I ask for prayers for me as I'm going through some things. I need your prayers. As your pastor is just being tested by God to a high designation of life. Just know this, that as I pray for you, continue and start to pray for me as I go forward. That's all I can say. Legally. But with all that being said, it's time for our announcements. I see that 4-9 has made it here today. Good to see you, 4-9. Good to see ya. All right, my beautiful wife is going to do it good. You can break the day, 4-9. That's her height, by the way.
At 8.
I ain't touching that one. I thought that was a little high for your age. All right.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Today is December the 4th, and our morning announcements are the second workshop that we're going to be having this coming up Saturday, December the 10th, from 10 a.m. to 12:30 p.m., is the seasonal anxiety dealing with the holiday blues. The holiday season is a joyous time, however, for some, it's not. So we ask that you come out and learn strategies to help you or someone else who's struggling with during this time of the season. Could be with the loss of a loved one, or it could be financial. Just come out and just, you know, learn tools that's going to help not only them, but then also you as well. So that is this Saturday from 10 to 12:30 p.m. And then this past week, Pastor went to a number of events in the community. As we have always said, the church is supposed to be a resource for the community. And they gave him several different resources for the residents of Maple Heights. And as I was looking at this at home, it's probably throughout the county as well. But what it is that it's a mobile food pantry that's actually over in Maple Heights at St. Andrew Eastern Orthodox Church, 16029 Maple Park Drive. They have that on the third Thursday from 9 until 11:30 a.m. They also have, if you're behind on your mortgage, they have assistance for that, assistance for rental assistance, winter crisis assistance, similar to what we're going to be doing this Saturday, water and sewer assistance, housing partners, and also property taxes. We do have flyers in the back. If you want, you can take them, or if you would like, we can email it to you. But please know that there are a number of assistants that's here to help not only you, but it could be a loved one or a friend. So I'll put them back in the back. And then as we continue with our Christian Unity Holiday Families, once again, I thank all of you all for being a blessing to the 8 families that we work for Thanksgiving. And what we're doing is we're going to be blessing 4 of those 8 families with Christmas gifts. We do have a list that the families have submitted to us of the requests that the kids have. As we stated before, these are basically families that have grandparents or either kinship that's helping to take on these families. And as you know, especially nowadays with the price of food and clothing, we all need assistance. So if you want to be a blessing to them, you know, you can see me or one of the ladies in the women's ministry, or you can email me. And as I was going through the list, I said, you know, it's good to see that it's not all about toys, books, art projects, it'll come back to me. But I said, you know, it was just good to see that everybody is not thinking about toys. So if you could be a blessing to them, please do. And also, don't forget that we do have our Wednesday night Bible study. It's at 7 p.m. It's virtual. If you need the link to that, just email Pastor. And then we also have
Good afternoon, everyone. Pray all is well. We would like to invite you out next Sunday for our, well, we always like to call it our December closeout year with our youth ministry, our praise dance ministry. Please come out and support us. They work really hard, and they would really love to see all of you here with them. Please invite someone even to come along with you, younger, older season, not season, whatever. Just, you know, support. Come in and enjoy. We have something planned really nice. So we want everyone to be a part of it with us. Thank you.
Amen.
Oh, and also, if you have anyone that you would like to, what am I trying to say, Sister Randy?
Participate.
To participate, that's it. Participate. Please let us know by today so we can get the information. Thank you.
Yeah, we will be doing a little refreshments afterwards to help to celebrate our youth next Sunday as well. And to our visitors, I know we have always said welcome, but I want to welcome you on behalf of me. Please know that whenever our doors are open, you are always welcome in this house because this is God's house. This is not half the house of my house, this is God's house. So again, welcome.
Amen. And also one other thing to say, that if you did not have your picture taken last week for the calendar that's coming out next year, and anything else we do at the end of service today, our videographer / photographer / everything, audio, Ms. Brandy Myers will be taking your pictures downstairs. And if you took it last week and you feel you want to do it again, you can. All right, it's okay. It's all right. And we're going to show you the best ones anyway. Not that any of you could ever take a bad picture anyway, because we have Photoshop. But you can never take a bad picture. So just know that you can do that. And then as we get ready for that, so we can get that stuff to the individuals that are handling the calendar for our church and the other things. And one other thing, too, we were in the process of sending out updates. Can you please, please update your address if you moved in the past year or two? Please see my wife so we can document your address. Because we sent out some nice things for Thanksgiving. Several were returned. And that way we could just have your address and we'll send you things. Trust me, it won't be a bill in it. It won't be nothing asking you for money. But just things to let you know that we're thinking about you, because we know in this virtual environment, well, a hybrid environment now, it's no longer virtual, that people need to hear from us. And there are some church members we have that physically cannot come to church. And we still need to love on them and connect on them. And some of you still like to receive mail that you can see, feel, open, touch, lay on the kitchen counter or dining room table, and all these other good things. So just let us, please see my wife. If you're not even sure if you've updated your address, please see her at the end of service so that we can get your address. We're not selling the information. We're not giving it to anybody. It'll only be here at the church, and we'll be using it for stuff dealing with the church. It's not going to the city. And one other thing, all the resources that my beautiful wife talked about are for the county. They're for the county. Property taxes, sewer, water bills, all that. And I did hear some good news. We got to wait to see how it passes out. You notice how some people in some of our communities are building these $300,000 or $400,000 houses next to a house that's worth $79,000, and the property taxes are going up. Somebody's addressing that in Congress so that doesn't happen. Somebody, I don't know how it's going to go in the state first, how that's going to go, because those of us that pay property taxes, because you paid $500,000 for your house. I can't get that for mine. So, but our property taxes, I heard rumor that is actually going to state legislature. So let's pray and hope for that, and continue to pray that Biden wins the student loan debate. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Jesus. Get that, take that demon out of our lives. Take it away. And we're going to pray for him and that endeavor to remove that so that we can continue to live and not be held hostage into the grave because we went to school. Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen. Because I'm one of those prisoners. It is what it is. But with all that being said, I'm grateful to be here. I'm glad our music industry here at ministry and our voices of praise and our deacon board and our mother's board looking good and all that white and red and everything. You know, I'm going to have to give me a red robe. I'm going to have to do that. Find one at Robes R Us. Hey, y'all know how to find discount candles. Can y'all find discount robes? You know, sure that y'all got a hookup somewhere. Don't Google it now. Please, don't do it now. But with all that being said, let's get ready to continue on with our worship service. As we call the finance committee, ushers, and the deacons forward, as we give unto God, as God has blessed us. Mm-hmm. Amen. You know what, this being Christmas season or Jesus' birth season, we know that it's always good to give. Because none of us can ever beat God giving, no matter how hard you try. Want to know why? Because on a fall day, he sent his only begotten son to be born on this earth, only to live for 33 years, to save it, to give up his life so that we could have eternal life. And that alone sometimes should make you shout, thinking about how good God is and can be and has been for each and every last one of us. God is blessing us in ways we can never count. Think about it outside. The sun rose, and guess what? We are still here. Guess what? They've had snowstorms throughout the country. Guess what? We just had a little frosting. Guess what? They're having tornadoes. Guess what? We're not having them. Guess what? They're having hurricanes. Guess what? People are stuck in places. Guess what? You're getting home back and forth every day. And it's not to say that God is punishing them, but never take for granted anything that God does for you. When you leave here today, many of you are going to go out to eat. Guess what? There are people who need to eat. Don't take that for granted. You're going home to a home. Many people don't have those. Don't take that for granted. Don't be sad that you got it. Don't ever be sad that God has blessed you. Just remember that you're blessed to be a blessing to someone else. And that's one thing that I love about you all at this church, with the stuff the women's ministry do and everything, is that you all are always perpetually thinking about other people. And he says, as God, as Jesus said in the commandments, love thy neighbor as thyself. If you are truly a Christian, you are obligated to love other people. You are obligated to be there for other people. You are obligated to be concerned about and actually show up and sometimes show out for the cause of someone who may not even know what to fight for or even know how. And if we don't do anything, we all can pray for somebody. If you know anybody that needs prayer today, be sure to pray for them. If you know anyone who's struggling, pray for them. If you know if there's any children out there who may not know where to be for this Christmas Eve or day, pray for them. And then when you can intercede, faith without works is what?
Dead.
Therefore, if you're a person of faith, you need to be working the work while it's still day, because the time is coming. So go out and help somebody some way. And like my wife said, yeah, kids are asked for crazy stuff, but in actuality, all that they really want is attention. Mm-hmm. All they really want is attention and somebody to do something with them. And most kids nowadays, like us when we were little kids, if you got some good food, you got my attention. And you can have it all day. You turn the TV on to something I want to see. For me, it was a Godzilla movie. Godzilla is one of the best method actors there ever has been. The only person that's better than him is Denzel Washington. Godzilla believes every movie he's in, I believe he's a monster. Some of y'all know who he is. Don't worry about it. I'm going to pray for you. I love it. And you know he's always going to win. I love it. But hey, know this, saints. As we continue on in our worship service, it is time for altar call, as Deacon Jones takes us to the throne of grace. You can stand, you can come forward, you can face forward, you can stay where you are, but you can feel comfortable with my hand.
Once more again, we come with thanksgiving in our heart, knowing that we worship the true and living God. And I'm just thankful for this day, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
But truly, I really didn't have to be. Because there were many days that you stepped in and took control over my life.
Thank you. Yes.
And allowed me to stand here today. I'm truly grateful, Heavenly Father, for I know that you have watched over me. You know, it's amazing how we go through life's highway, and think that somehow we can come up with all the answers by ourselves. You see, sometimes it takes a little while for you to learn that you cannot make it without God.
got too many things, too many obstacles, too many times of danger that you're going to have to go through, and you have no answer. And I'm thankful, Heavenly Father, that you never left me alone. You always found my side. Even when I thought I'd do it all, Heavenly Father, I was able to get, make it on my own. You showed me that I didn't know nothing about life. Not even as the young folks say, jack about life. And I'm thankful, Heavenly Father, that I had the nerve to walk in church one day and give myself to you. From that day on, I've never regretted, Heavenly Father, because you opened my eyes to things that I never understood before. You gave me a peace in mind and heart to be able to accept things even when someone did wrong to me. You still kept love in my heart. Put love in my heart to be able to have children, to be able to raise them in you, and to lead them into your house, Heavenly Father. Truly, I know that you have all the answers. You are our beginning and our end. And we're thankful, Heavenly Father, that you will never let us go astray without giving us some sort of warning. Letting us know that this is not the right path that you should be taking. And I'm thankful, Heavenly Father, that you tell me one day in a special way, Heavenly Father, to let me know that truly you are the living God, and that there is no other way that we should live without serving you. And I'm thankful, Heavenly Father, that you allow me to become a servant of yours, to be able to stand before people and tell them, or to have a testimony of your love and your mercy and your grace. Truly, Heavenly Father, there's nothing we can do without you. Become rich and famous or whatever, but nevertheless, it won't be enough. Because, see, I heard of rich people every day taking their lives. And we look at them as having everything. But hey, we know that you, life doesn't work like that. Unless we accept you in our life, hey, that tranquility, that peace of mind, that happiness does not last unless we look into you, Heavenly Father. And I'm thankful, Heavenly Father. Let that light shine on me, Heavenly Father. And it gave me the understanding that I need to know that I can always lean and depend on you. And ask Heavenly Father that you continue to bless our pastor, this pastor. Continue to give us the strength to carry on in your name. We know that there are some places out there, some churches claim to be bringing forth your word, Heavenly Father, but nevertheless, there are a lot of things that's hidden that it takes time to understand. We ask, Heavenly Father, that you can continue to lead and guide our every footstep. And we ask all these blessings in your darling Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
have to continue to praise God no matter what. You know, you praise God because you got a paycheck, but you worship God because your paycheck was not enough. That'll hit you later. That's a whole other message. I want you to understand something. Be thankful, but you don't stop worshiping God just because things don't go your way. Your circumstances can never dictate your connection to Christ. If that was true, a whole lot of us would not be where we are today. Amen? Amen. Amen. Now, saints of God, I'm continuing on with part 5 of Christian Unity. And the message is, the truth is out there, only in God. The truth is out there, only in God. Now, our passage for today is continuing in Ephesians 4. And before I go on, we have a word of prayer. Most precious Heavenly Father, I surrender myself unto you, asking you, dear God, for today, that you, dear God, to touch the hearts and minds and someone, dear God, that is in here today that may need to connect with you, reconnect with you, or just join with this church, dear God, as we go forward. We just ask you, O Lord, to open the hearts and minds of all those under the sound of my voice and take out Terry A. Webb. I don't matter, dear God. I'm nothing but a vessel. I'm just a bunch of things thrown together with a few germs every now and then, too, dear God, because I am just an earthen vessel that has a spirit in it that is going to be with you one day. Just help me, O Lord, to minister to your people. This is your church. These are your people. Dear God, please manifest your presence. Be with us, O Lord. Continue to bless Christian Union Baptist Church. Lead, guide, direct, and protect everyone under the sound of my voice. Let nothing, nowhere, at any given time ever deter us from worshiping you in spirit and in truth and praising you, dear God, everywhere that we go. Thank you, dear God, for all the many bountiful and blessed things you've done for us, for bringing us this far. Continue to increase our territory as we seek to do all we can to keep these neon lights brightly shining in this church and continuing on in a matter such that someone somewhere may look at each one of us and say, there's something special about you, there's something peculiar about you, and that is the manifestation of the Lord Savior, Jesus Christ, in us, dear God, emanating, resonating in a manner, dear God, that people are drawn to us like a moth to a flame. Help us, dear God, to be all you created us to be. Just help us, dear God, to stay on this right road, this narrow road, to make the crooks in our lives straight, and be willing to live the life that is pleasing unto you in every aspect, in every dynamic, in every way possible, to love as you love, dear God. You don't look for conditions. You love us because love is a condition that a Christian is supposed to have. You never said it would be easy. You just said we had to do it. You said that we must, and today, dear God, we surrender ourselves unto you. Help us, O Lord, in everything we do. Bless this service and everyone in here and their families, and keep them safe from hurt, harm, or danger. We pray this in all things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now, saints of God, this morning, this is one passage here. It's actually more than one, but it's one passage here. Ephesians 4:25. And remember, Ephesians 4:25, if you can stand, please stand for the reading of God's holy word. If you can stand. Amen. I believe everybody has turned, swiped, or whatever they need to do to be there. Do I hear any amens as to affirmation?
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. All right. Remember, I'm reading from the Christian Standard Bible that a beloved church member gave me. This in huge type. God bless them. Therefore, putting away lying, speak the truth, each one to his neighbor, because we are members of one another. Amen. 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 Now, what I want to do for a quick retort real quick is that as we talk about in Bible study, I want you to really read the Bible, not have read the Bible. It say, therefore, putting away lying. That means stop. That means cease. That means desist. That means don't do it. That means no, no, no. That means stop it. That doesn't mean that you haven't done it. I love when people say, I've never told a lie. You just lied.
Amen.
If you've ever been on a date, that is the best lie ever. Because you present to be something that you may not fully be. And I thank God that I'm not young now, considering the things that are possible with the internet. So I therefore, putting away lying, speak the truth, each one to his neighbor. Now, I have to put a disclaimer in there. You speaking the truth is not you debasing or putting somebody else down. Or check this out. Woo, people don't like this one. Putting somebody in their place. It ain't your place to put somebody in their place unless you're in the right place. And until you can actually walk and you are free of sin, and you are free of crazy thoughts, and you free of malicious acts, until you free of gossip, until you free of lying, until you free of greed and jealousy and envy, until you free of gluttony, until you are free of materialism, until you are free of just out and out petty backbiting, you have no right to do that. It is our job to love one another, and this is why God is charging us in the scripture to not lie. That doesn't mean that we placate people by giving them false assertions. That doesn't mean that we don't address things that are wrong. Because if you're addressing something that is wrong with the word of God, then you're doing what God has called you to do. The problem is we address it according to the word of God, according to the word of Kanye, according to the word of Jay-Z, or Beyonce, or Oprah. Their words don't matter except to them. What matters most is the word of God. If a situation arises, you look at that situation right here, and then you get the word of God, you do a search, and now you have Yahoo and Google. You can search for that, what that is. Even if you have anxiety issues, you can Google anxiety and look in the Bible and find reliable sources. If you don't know what they are, I'll give you some. Then you can juxtapose those two things, and when you address the anxiety, you address them with the ideas of God, not of Albert Ellis or Freud. Not people who are human beings like you who are after these things because they're struggling with them. God has a way. I'm not saying that these conditions don't exist, but what I'm saying is whatever you're facing, God has an answer. His plan is to prosper you, not to harm you. So many of us lose sight of God because something didn't go our way. That's because you didn't do it His way. And sometimes God will do this, take His hands off of us, and let us say, go have that. I know a couple of times in my life, He let me do that, and I thank God I'm still here. I don't know about you, it might be somebody perfect who's never done that. But I thank God that God brought me out, and it wasn't all right, and sometimes it costs money. But I'm here today to testify that you should not do anything outside of the will of God. And you know what? The enemy wants to make us believe a lot of lies. The enemy wants to keep us off kilter. The enemy wants to make us focus on things that we cannot change. Remember, I posted something about that. If we stop focusing on the stuff that we can't change and start focusing on what God can do, it'll be amazing how we might minimize our gray hair, the loss of hair, the nights that we can't sleep, the tossing and the turning, the midnight eating. I'm not talking about for the greedy, I'm talking for the needy. The things that we do that actually take away from the quality of our life. You know, for instance, I'm going to drive it home this way. There was a friend of mine that I went to college with and didn't have the chance to work with. I no longer work with her. She always wanted a family. She always wanted this somebody to settle down with, so she always wanted a husband. But because she listened to the lies of the enemy that had been generational, that were passed down to her, she was stuck in what could be and never saw what God was trying to give her. So she had been in some bad relationships. Is there anybody in here besides me that has been in some hellacious relationships? Some of us in here have been divorced, you've been lied on, you've been lied to, you've been abused, you've been battered, you've been bankrupt, you've been neglected, you've been verbally castigated. Some of us in here know what it is to be hooked up to a fool. Well, let me talk about myself. I know firsthand that I have eaten from the grapevine and tried to eat every grape on the vine until I found the vine to put me in the right line. I don't know about you. I haven't been where I am right now all my life. But she struggled with this, and she finally met a guy that a friend introduced her to. Now, I don't do that. People be like, I want to meet your friend. You better do it yourself. I ain't introducing you to nobody because I ain't never dated. If he act like a fool, because you my friend, I got to beat him down and I can never be your friend again. I lost two friends for one introduction. No, you make this mess. So here we go. She introduced him to this guy. She has a college education. She has a master's degree. She's doing well. She done built a nice house down in Virginia area, doing all these great things. She's like the Joneses, and a lot of people members of this church is bald. And so she's doing real well. She got a car. She got a motorcycle. Got all these things. She meets this guy. This guy falls in love with her. She started saying some things to this guy. This guy falls in love with her. He just like love at first fright. Sight. But the thing of it is now, he introduces her to his kids. So they ain't young. They like in their 40s then. He introduced her to his kids. He introduced her to his family. He take over to Thanksgiving. And then she's mad because he won't take her somewhere that he's going with his friends. And her friend, and this is where everybody needs a real friend. Well, what a friend we have in Jesus, and Jesus will put a real person in your life. Now, she has bought into these lies about how stuff is. You know, Granny told her some things like, you can't trust no man when he ain't in front of you. Don't let him be around other women. He gonna be thinking about them. Girl, don't never let no man know where all your money is. That's why some of y'all knew how to do this. So good. Some of y'all got so good at how in here, you can put a 40 and a quart up here and still keep pumping. Don't ever let no man have your last. Don't ever let no man tell you what to do. Don't ever let nothing. The problem with that information is Granny never met a man. She met a male that was genitalia specific. See, she's telling you these things, and listen to this. Girl, you better put some money away for yourself. And then she bought into these lines. She asked a man, what you putting money away for yourself? You should be saving money anyway. Your money should not be on the exit strategy. Because if you go into something, into a contract with the pretense that it's going to fail, guess what? It's going to fail. You go into these relationships expecting marriage. I ain't talking about dating. Dating ain't gonna lie anyway. But the thing about it is, and it's your marriage is on the pretense that it's going to succeed. I tell my best lies on the date. Woo. I don't know about y'all. It was real good ones. I could have been epic movies. But the thing of it is that in the process of this, she's not enjoying what God has given her because she's anticipating betrayal. She can't even let her guards down. Her guard is locked tighter than Fort Knox. She's so focused on what everybody told her. Me gonna do this. Harpo gonna beat you. No, he ain't. A man ain't gonna beat you. That's the P-U-N-K. And you shouldn't sit back and justify it and accept it and say, he only beats me when he got money. Where? What happened to you in the lottery? You better become Bruce Lee. So the thing about it is this. She expects, anticipates betrayal when God is trying to open up her mind, and she's mad at this man because he didn't take her to this event that he was going to, and she's avoiding commitment. He's trying to clamp her down. In the words of Beyonce, he wants to put a ring on it, but every time he comes to their finger, she puts it away. Then she wondered why won't he do anything? Because she's still in her head saying, you can't let no man dominate you. A man ain't going to dominate you once again. You need to stop listening to your unhappy mama who never really had a man. And your sad grandmama who never really had a man. And many people, God has given them a man and they ran him away. Read 1st and 2nd Corinthians. How many women have a husband but want to say, no, 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 no? And some of y'all know what I'm talking about. Shut down the store. Then wonder why he goes to a second class Aldi's. If you're married, you don't do that. Ever. It's biblical. You might say, no, don't say no. You say, not now. That's up to you how fast the clock runs. But she's struggling. And she's extremely suspicious of everything. Everything this man does. I remember years ago, gotta be about 25 years ago, a woman broke up with me on my birthday
because I was too nice to her. I'm in the pulpit, I ain't lying.
Oh.
She took me out for my birthday. It was that Denny's or something out there in you. Because back then, in the 80s, black folks thought Houston was a suburb. Yeah. And they thought it was a suburb. And she said, it broke up with me. Said, you're too nice to me. You take care of me and doing stuff for me. What you up to? And I'm thinking, nigglet, I'm supposed to be nice to you. If I'm nice to you, you should be nice to me. But you know what? Some of us bought into the lie. That man being too nice to you.
Well, you know what? You are created in the image of God. He's supposed to be that nice to you. He's supposed to treat you the right way. My wife can tell you, I ain't never cussed at her or cussed out loud. And then the thing about being here, I ain't never did that. I'm not going to do it. All this time, 22 years we've been together, I ain't did it, and I don't plan on doing it. I can't even think of those words like that in the right order now to make it even sound good. But you're suspicious, and you see what? And some people have bought into this lies and the things about relationships, and this is what this passage is all about. You can't trust nobody. I don't trust nobody. I can't let nobody get close to me. I can't do this. I can't do that. Then they bring, this is the problem. This is the issue that is really prevalent in the black church. People still bring who they are to church. They just put it in better clothing. So the brokenness that you had out there on the street is just well-dressed in the church. So in the church, those of us who are maturing in our faith cannot allow the infants in the faith to make us live a lie. You do not allow individuals who have not learned about Jesus tell you who Jesus is. See, the thing is, what happens is that people get confused. There's a difference between being able and being willing. God is able to do anything, but he ain't always willing to come alongside you, especially if you're not living out his truth. So many of us get it twisted. God let my mama die. Your mama deserves her eternal reward. Who are you to make us lay here and suffer? Who are you to dictate to God how things work out? I stopped going to church because this died, this happened, I lost this, I went this. Everything you have, God gave it to you for a season. Amen. And you ought to be grateful that God thought enough of you to give you a mama that you could marry, a job that you could miss, a house that you could lose. There are a lot of children that don't even know their mama. Ain't never had a job. Ain't never lived in a house. You have had much more than other people will ever have. Stop believing the lie that God is going to do what you want him to do. God's going to do what's best for you. And sometimes, I remember my internet preacher I listened to. This couple prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed to conceive a baby. They finally conceived one. I think she was 42. And they stopped coming to church for 5 years. They finally came back to church. And then they said, what do you want to happen? Well, the mothers of this church was real. They said, we want the baby to die. Mm-hmm. Oh, follow, don't crack, don't get emotional. Here we go. The reason that they didn't really want the baby to die, but they really want them. Don't give up on God when God blessed you. They totally did everything the Hebrews did. Just because God gave them something, they turned their back on God. And you know why they came to church? Because the baby was sick. It's amazing how we treat God. The truth about God, he ain't a pull in case of emergency. You should have an urgency to be with God every day. If your eyes open up, you should have an urgency to be with God. If your body moves, you have an urgency to be with God. If you know who you are, where you are, and you're somewhere warm in the winter, you should be excited that God got you where you are. You don't put God on the side until everything goes wrong. God ain't a call in case of all hell breaking loose. If you know God, when hell break loose, you can walk through it calmly, because God is with you, and he's more than a world against you. Yes. every time. But if you're a child of God living in the truth, you don't let what's in front of you make you bow down to it. You raise your hands up to God. And sometimes you got to say, help me. That's it. You don't need a long prayer. Help me. God, I'm here. Help me. And God will step in when he's willing. And he will show up and show out. But for some of us, he got to let us be in a fire a little longer. Because you're only coming because something's wrong. You need to thank God when the sun shines. You need to thank God when it's a blizzard. You need to thank God when it's a hurricane, a tsunami. You need to thank God when you get your paycheck and you ain't got nobody to pay. You need to thank God when you ain't, when you got your check and you can't pay everybody. But thank God that you can pay somebody, because God knows that you can't pay everybody. But he is the somebody that can take care of anybody, that can silence everybody, to put you in a place that you need to be, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. And today, you need to know who God is in your life. And the thing is about truth is this. John MacArthur has a great definition of biblical truth. The truth is that which is consistent with the mind, the will, the character, glory, and being of God. As I open up with, if you can't find God, you need to throw it away. It ain't for you. Even more to the point, truth is the self-expression of God. That is the biblical meaning of truth. If it's of God, it's the truth. Because God, as we said a couple of weeks ago, is immutable. Well, no, son, if it's wrong in God's eyes on Sunday, guess what's wrong on Monday? Guess what's wrong on Tuesday? Guess what's wrong on Wednesday? Guess what's wrong on Thursday? Just because you're on a date on Friday doesn't mean that you take it out like dentures and leave your morals at home. It's still wrong. Because when you wake up Saturday morning and inebriated, convoluted, can't find your underwear, you're still wrong. Then you come in here on Sunday to hear the truth. But all it does is do a boomerang on your ears. Come on. God throws it. Soon as he says something, I don't want to do that. Boo, it's gone. And truth is also ontological. It's a fancy way of saying everybody experiences it. You got people saying they don't believe in God, but they sure enjoy a sunshine and a sunset. Guess what? They enjoy being on the lake, fishing, going on a good time, one, two, and three. I think three's still up, so we don't have four yet. But the thing about it is, do you understand? If you are saved, you should not desire to live a life other than that of the truth. Not to demoralize or look down upon others. You're supposed to walk the walk, talk the talk, and live the life that you profess. If you're a child of God, if you're really true to God, guess what? You can't cuss me out. Guess what? You can't take advantage of me. Guess what? If you have children, you can't neglect them. Guess what? If you marry, you don't accidentally have sex with somebody else. You married the one you got. Come on, sing that Barry White. You and me. Let's hang up this Christmas tree. Christians are not to be puffed up and pretentious either on how they speak, act, and live. Do you know what I love when I'm around Christians? I would never do that. Nigga, you ain't been caught. None of us has the right to look at anybody else and act like we so holy that we are above somebody else. The difference is they live in their truth. You gargle to get the liquor off your breath. You put long sleeves on to cover the track marks. And you put on a suit to take away the stench that you had on you of sin the night before. You have no right to be pretentious and pretending that I am a Christian. Hear me roar. When I walk in the door, you're supposed to stand tall. Because I am the righteous. No, you ain't. You're waiting to get caught. That's all it is. And this is why God wants us to stop lying, so that we can get away from all of these pretensions and all of these false assertions and this old wise tale stuff that we had that divides his body of believers in the church. Everybody can't be the head, but everybody ain't going to be the tail. As we said 3 weeks ago, we one big jigsaw puzzle. Each one of you is a piece. Find out where you fit in and let your blessings begin. Therefore, relationships are going to be tough. That's why he said put away lying. Oh, it's in you. Oh, it's in you. It's in your DNA. Because the devil is everywhere. He's going to lead you to believe a whole lot of stuff. He leads some guys to believe that if your pants legs so skinny that your bottom of your pants is hanging off of you and your suit too little that you look good. He led some women to believe that if your eyelash is long enough to be whisk brooms, then it's cute. He led some of y'all to believe that your little 11-year-old daughter with 22 pounds of weave on her hair down to her knees and her name ain't Rapunzel is cute. The baby's neck hurting because she can't even move. We've been led to believe that tattoos on our face is actually an expression of artistic equity, when in reality it's more of being a crazy freak of nature. God gave you that nose, you can't hide it. God gave you them eyes, you can't hide it. Everybody can't be skinny, but everybody can be a child of God. Amen. See, you know what? Christians are to speak the truth of God and not let the world malign what is proper to make sin acceptable. See, so many of us debase people that don't do what we want to do, then we run over here and support someone else who is doing something that is just as evil as the person that we talked about, but we ain't friends with them, we friends with them. Oh, that'll hit you later. Mm-hmm. Speaking God's truth and love is the counsel. Understand this. Dwight Moody said something really powerful. God never made a promise that was too good to be true. If God said it, it will be done. Knowing God's truth is far better than being ignorant. Billy Graham. The Bible must be considered the greatest source of all the truth by which people are to live their lives on earth as it is in heaven. This is the life's instruction manual. Do you understand? Everyone has faults. Everyone experiences failure. Everyone has weaknesses. Everybody in here got something that they don't want somebody else to know. Everybody in here that done something that they don't ever want anybody else to know. Everybody in here that experienced failure. There's nothing that is common to people that everybody ain't experienced. People say, I ain't never failed at anything. Well, then therefore you've never been successful at anything either. Want to know something everybody failed at? Walking. Some of y'all know y'all head was extraordinarily large when you learned how to walk. So you started walking like this. And you fell over. Guess what? Because you didn't believe the lies of the devil, you got back up. No one ever told you you couldn't get back up. But at 15, someone could tell you, like, maybe I got anxiety and I can't walk. You get the difference later. Everybody in here has failed at riding a bike. Some of y'all still failed at driving cars. Guess what? You bought one. Guess what? They'll keep selling to you too. Even if your license is questionable. They will. Everybody has weaknesses. And just like the devil in Matthew 4 took Jesus, of all people, the Lord, to the top of a mountain to offer him something that's already his. The devil will do the same thing to you. Get you to believe that he's going to give you something that you already got. The devil leads you to believe that you're missing something that you're not supposed to have. So many times we look at what everybody else got that we can't enjoy what God has given us. I remember Perry saying, what God has for me, guess what? It is for me. I don't need what you got. I need what God has for me. Sometimes when you unpack a beautiful gift, you realize it's a pus-bursting sore. Because you don't know how it got to where it is what it's got to do to stay there. I'm not willing to compromise my faith in order to have something to look good to broke people or broken people. See, you know what? We must live this biblical truth. Don't let your participation in organizations, political parties, social order, family, community, or places of worship stop you from worshiping God. See, some of y'all are so in touch with God that when you walk into a tumultuous situation, there's a calm that ensues. Because that God is all over you. Kind of like the back and bodywork cameras y'all go crazy over. When you walk in the room, there's an odor. Not a bad one. I'm going to say a scent because the odor got a bad connotation. A scent. A sense of joy. A sense of love. A sense of patience. A sense of humility. All that is mixed together with love. And when you walk into the room, some of you know what I'm talking about. You meet some people you just can't act crazy with. Some of you met, hopefully you the person that you can't act crazy with. If not, talk to Jesus and he'll make it all right. And the thing of it is that we have to recognize and learn to lead a life that is pleasing unto God and not let our weaknesses be exploited because what you did in the past ain't who you are right now. So many of us live a lie, allow people to keep us prisoner because we're fixated on what we did. I don't even talk to people anymore. Man, when we did it back in 73, no. If you ain't did nothing since then, as normal besides that, you probably need to go and die, dog. But why are you here? All Christians can overcome failure. Turn it over to Jesus. All Christians are prone to failure. What you have to do is that if it were not for failure, you would know what success tastes like. If it were not for failure, you would know how to progress at anything. If it were not for failure, you would have no wisdom. Don't discount the negative occurrences in your life because I now know some of the things that I've been through are things that I never ever want to do again. Do I have a witness? Some of the things in life that we've been through, I never ever want to go through again. And guess what? If I'm ever walking and it pops up, I do this. Because I know what that's about. I'm all about him right now. I can't go back there. I won't go back. I can't go back and I will not. And we need to understand, too, the big disease that keeps a lot of us away from the truth is I cannot be wrong disease. That disease is worse than Ebola, syphilis, gonorrhea, COVID. It's actually epic. I cannot be wrong. So you know what? Talking to them, don't argue with them. Because you're talking to the wrong person. Find somebody else to talk to and leave them on that isle of Patmos to have their eyes puffed out by the birds. Do not argue or engage a person that cannot be wrong. Because I love when people say, I used to hear people say that when I was a teacher. Oh, my child don't apologize. Oh, your child don't anywhere to head. My child can't say they sorry. I've even heard women say, my husband never says sorry because he is sorry. That's why he can't say it. If you can't admit that you're wrong, then therefore you're not even worth the oxygen, in my opinion, that you get. Everybody has been wronged. Because everybody has been wronged. And so then therefore we don't focus on that. Well, you know, can't nobody. You know something else too, the little truth? You got to be learning to forgive. And forgive doesn't mean forget. It means that you release yourself of the angst so you can go on and live your life. Forgiveness is not about the other person or the offender. Forgiveness is about you being whole. We get so caught up, well, they won't say they sorry. They might be too sorry to say they sorry. And some people don't even understand. I remember in seminary, we read a story about this guy who was like a Grinch. He went through all this stuff, did all these evil things, and he struggled really hard with his health and his mental condition and everything, and he just pushed everybody away from him, and people were like, he hurt my feelings so bad, and he never, ever, 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 ever apologized, and he did all this to me, and I was treated this way, and I was done unfairly when we worked for him and everything, but all this was going on in this man's life. This man died in his home. For 30 days, nobody knew he was dead. Wanna know why? Because his body was racked with cancer from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. Do you realize it's not your job to get revenge on anybody? God will get them. And can't nobody get you like God. Don't worry about the offender. Worry about you not offending God. That's what you focus on if you want to live the truth. And don't focus on your weakness is nothing but you to get a chance to improve on. Everybody in here has a moral weakness. Oh, a simple one of mine is a suit outlet. I lose my mind.
Mm-hmm. I love suits. If they had them for $49, $59, I know it's wash and wear and probably going to last 3 months. But you know what? I'm going to get that suit. I'm going to walk around that suit. I'm going to strut like a peacock on court today with that suit on, with my fresh ties and shirts and stuff with it. But it's a problem. But unlike, I know nobody in here has ever done this. It's, the problem is like some of y'all, when y'all go to Marks and find a good deal, one of them at $3 was good, but did you have to buy 30? So I figured you'd catch it when I said it that way. Did you really need 30? And if you're buying something that you have to start giving stuff away, you bought too much! And let this out. And our weaknesses actually are good for us because it provides us an opportunity to connect to the saving grace of God. Because what you can't do, He can. You don't need to be 100% strong. You need to be 100% dependent on Him. You need to understand that when you're facing the roadblock, that you allow God to push you up that roadblock. You need to understand that God uses the foolish things of this world to shame those who consider themselves to be better than you. Well, ain't nobody better than you, because if you find a way for somebody to die and worms not eat them, then they think they're better than you. That's the only way if you ain't raptured. The truth is in you, saints. Don't ever think for a second that you don't have the truth in you. Stop squashing it. Stop pushing it down. Stop ignoring it. Stop letting it sit in the corner and snivel up because you are worried about relationships with individuals that are not worthy to be in relationship with, when you need to make sure that your relationship to God is as solid as a rock. Steel and adamantium. And think about this. I'm going to ask you a question and you give me the answer. The question I'm going to provide you with is the solution. And it's the same answer to every question. Who is the Father of Jesus? This is where you answer. All right, class, let's try this again. I'm going to ask the question. You know the answer. When I do this, you say it, and I want you to raise this roof off. Who is the Father of Jesus? Who parted the Red Sea?
God.
Who made a brown cow eat green grass and produce white milk is overpriced?
God.
Who gave Moses the Ten Commandments?
God.
Who put Jonah in the belly of a Leviathan and he was not eaten?
God.
Who made the lion a vegetarian and not eat Daniel?
God.
Who made the fire not burn the 3 Hebrew boys?
God.
Who cared for your family when you were down to your last dime?
God.
Who gave you the courage to leave where you were to find a better way of life?
God.
Who got you home that night you were out drunk driving?
God.
Who brought you out of that bad situation?
God.
Who rescued you from danger seen and unseen?
God.
Who opened up the windows of heaven and poured you out countless blessings? Who fed your family when you had a minimum wage job?
God.
Who paid your rent when all your money was spent?
God.
Who was that man in the bush when you didn't have anything in the cupboard, but you went in there? Somebody came and your kids ain't.
God.
Who is the way, the truth, and the life?
God.
Say it like you mean it.
God.
Say it again.
God.
Say it like you mean it.
God.
You have the truth in you. You have God. We must be agents of truth. If we have the light of Christ in us, the only truth there is the truth of God. And without God, there is no truth. So you better stop lying. You better stop pretending. You better be strong. You better walk in faith and not by sight. You better not let someone tell you that our God ain't real. Because He's healed us. He's delivered us. He's provided for us. He saved us. He hung on the cross to be buried in a burial tomb to get up on the third day with all power in His hand. So I don't care what you think. All I care is what does my God say. And God said that you are Christian Unity, are somebody, somewhere, all the time, because God loves you just the way you are.
you don't have a future. Don't let somebody tell you that you messed up and you can't be forgiven. You know what, saints? No matter what we go through in life, if you are a child of God who created you, there's a plan for your life. There's a destiny in this church. There's a destiny in your future. There's a destiny in your family. There's a destiny in your community. Do you understand, saints? No lie, which is a weapon that is formed against you, will ever prosper. We are to bond together in the super glue of faith in our Lord and Savior. So, Lord, we thank you for the lies that have been told on us. Come to expose who we're dealing with. We thank you, dear God, for coming in your glory. We thank you, dear God, for all that you have done. We know that no lie, no evil, nothing can ever touch us. Because we got you on our side. If anybody in here knows that God is able, let me hear you say amen. Do you know that God is waiting? Beloved, we must know that God has declared that we can go into a fiery furnace and not get burned. God has declared that you can live on in any situation if you stand on His promises, if you stand on His word. You might cry when you pray, but continue to cry, continue to pray, continue to cry, continue to pray, continue to cry, continue to pray. As He said in Revelation, He will wipe every tear from your eyes. Don't ever give up on God. He's declared that He can bring light out of darkness, and He sure can get you out of the mess you're in right now. If anybody agrees with me, let me hear you say hallelujah. I want to hear you say something. Clap your hands and stomp your feet. I want you to raise the roof in here, because our prayer will take out every lie of the devil. The devil can't stop us. Our prayer kills the devil. It blocks the lies. It sets us free to love one another in the way that God wants it to be. It matters not what the devil is doing. Are we loving God? Are we serving God? Are we allowing ourselves to be used by God? Let your praise be heard in heaven. Release it. I pray in the name of Jesus, release it. Whatever lies binding you, whatever problem befronts you, release it unto Jesus. Let Him take it away. It don't matter what they say. What does He say? It don't matter what they think. What does God think? Who you are in Christ Jesus is paramount to your faith. So as we get ready to open the doors of the church, come to God now. Don't stay stuck in this lie that you can do it on your own. You need Jesus. You need Him. When you come, make up your mind. Let God have His way with you. Will you? When you come, will you? Make up your mind. Don't let a lie stop you. About you, on you, or even with you. Only God is true.
And if you believe in God, you will have a way out of no way. Because God said he will never leave us or forsake us. The truth is out there, and it's only in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen, saints. So let's get ready for Holy Communion.
This do in remembrance of me. And after the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak, and sickly among you, and many sleep. Amen. Most precious Heavenly Father, we the saints of God united here today in corporate worship at Christian Unity Baptist Church, ask you, dear God, to anoint and bless these sacraments, dear God, of your representation, your body and blood. Let them be worthy for us to take part in this holy sacrament, dear God, that is one of the sacraments of the Baptist Church. We ask you, dear God, to anoint these offerings, dear God, as we seek to recognize, commemorate, and memorialize that sacrifice that you did for us that day on Calvary. That we know in the upper room with your apostles that you said that you had to go do what you did. And we thank you today, O Lord, for all that you have done, can do, and will do. Make this be worthy and bless everyone in a manner, dear God, that it cleanses them and connects them with you, such that they will know that you are Lord all by yourself. Thank you today, O Lord, for this opportunity to take part in the Holy Communion. We pray this in all things in the mighty, matchless, marvelous name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
We have the covenants. Okay, alright. Make sure you got one, huh? You did this once, y'all ready? Let's go!
Every day as we believe by the Spirit of God to see the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior and on the profession of our faith, having been baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, we do now.
And what are some of the privileges and duties in this, our church?
We may be made more by the aid of the Holy Spirit to walk together in Christian love, to strive for the advancement of this church in knowledge, holiness, and power, to sustain its worship, ordinances, discipline, and doctrines.
What vows do we gladly make as stewards of that which God has entrusted to us?
To contribute cheerfully and prayerfully to the support of the ministry, the expense of the church, the relief of the poor, and the spread of the gospel through all nations.
For the sake of our homes, loved ones, what task do we humbly assume?
We engage to maintain family and secret devotions, to religiously take care of our children, to seek the salvation of our kindred and acquaintances.
For the sake of the unsaved for whom Christ died, to what manner of life and conversations are we to model?
To walk circumspectly in the world, to be just in dealings, faithful in our engagements, and exemplary in our deportment, to avoid all tattling, backbiting, and excessive anger, to abstain from sale and use of intoxicating liquors as a beverage, and to be diligent in our efforts to advance the kingdom of our Savior.
For the sake of our Christian brothers and sisters, we are to be there for one another.
We further engage to watch over one another, brother and love, to remember one another in prayer, to aid each other in sickness and distress, to cultivate Christian sympathy and building healing for this crazy to be restored to the Lord of the heavens, all these prayers for reconciliation and mind of the rules of our Savior.
For the good of our spiritual development, what do we promise to do if we move beyond the reach of this church?
We more will engage that when we move from this place, we will, as soon as possible, unite with some of the churches of this faith, where we can bear our spiritual development and come
into the presence
of God's word.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
everyone that served and desires to be served at our communion is for the baptized believer. If you notice, some of you have the new white glasses. I say, hey, I promise them, but we ain't doing with old stuff yet. Ain't there yet. We're not the challenge. So some of you have that, and it is contained. Is everyone able to open it up to get to the bread? Amen.
Amen.
I'm worried about the doctor. Might not be able to do it. Everybody's been served. All right, let's give it to Holy Communion. We have the bread, which is a representation of the body of Jesus, broken and beaten for our sins. Let us eat together. We have the wine, which is a representation of the blood that was shed that day on Calvary by our Lord for the remission of our sins. Let us all drink together. Until we meet again, be blessed. Amen. Amen.